In this edition of Art Loft, sculptures that defy description and gravity.
To me, the poetry of his description was exactly like somebody would describe sculpture.
A South Florida institution that has the juice.
I was just 6 years old. I sat there all day long.
Photography meets rock and roll.
So oftentimes I take on the identity of purely being a rock and roll photographer.
And young artists spread their wings. It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation, the Miami-Dade County Tourist Development Council, the Miami-Dade County Department of Cultural Affairs and the Cultural Affairs Council, the Miami-Dade County Mayor, and the Board of County Commissioners. And
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Kalyn James, and from the Cultural Center of Spain in Miami, this is Art Loft. Phyllida Barlow is a British artist living and working in London. Barlow's sculptural practice centers on her experimentation with materials that are easily overlooked and often found in the urban environment in which she lives. Cardboard, fabric, plywood, wire, scrim, and cement are among her favorites, and she manipulates them to create sculptures that defy simple description. Barlow's work is currently on display at the Norton Museum of Art in an exhibition that's called, what else? Horde. Let's take a look.
I'm Phyllida Barlow. I'm an artist. I make sculpture, large installations and smaller works and drawings. The columns are made from a polystyrene core that's coated with scrim and cement and ribbons, all bound together in the cement. They go 6 meters high, which is about 20 foot, 18 foot, something like that. Some works there is a clarity about what they are, and other works there is no clarity, and I work across the two different ways of working, but nearly all the work is subjected to quite a lot of change in the process of making, even if I have a clear idea. I knew for the column work that I wanted columns, but I wasn't entirely sure how they would finally end up. They began as very clear cylindrical objects stacked on top of each other, and then I thought they looked, for me, very bland, so I began to work into the polystyrene, allowing it to be randomly eaten away by cutting into it, which I did with a team of assistants. And then I'm fascinated by materials that go through a natural process of change, like plaster cement. Those materials that begin as a powder, then you add a liquid to them and they become a very different kind of materials. They seem to have a lifespan of their own, and I'm curious about working with that process. So these are working with cement as a very modeled surface over the core of polystyrene. And I had the idea of, I like the idea of materials colliding with each other or clashing, and ribbons and cement seem a very opposing kind of combination. And so the column is a kind of cliche of monumentalism, but I was quite interested in trying to somehow undermine that. And so the ruined look of them and them being kind of bound in ribbons which are half submerged by the cement surface for me is a kind of comment on maybe things that have outlived their moment of grandeur and become something else. It's based on an upturned house. I mean, I think whatever the starting point is for me, I always want the work to travel some way away from that. I'm not particularly interested in thinking of an image and then making that. I'm interested in triggers to a process of making, and then that takes over and becomes the work. But the upturned houses, this is the third out of three, and they had a very, very specific starting point. Listening to a program on the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina, and the journalist reporter was interviewing various people who've been through the experience and all the tragic circumstances that surrounded Katrina. But one account in particular really struck me because it was so solitary and so heroic in its own kind of unsung way. It was a man who went to find his house after the great assault of the flooding river. And he'd been in this sports center and then set out to find his house. And he knew where to go exactly. But the further he went towards the streets were where he lived, the more flattened they were and absolutely drenched in this thick, thick silt. And then he saw his house. But he didn't mention the word house. He mentioned the word home. He said, I saw my home. And he approached it and he realized the whole structure had been turned completely upside down and his home was resting on its roof. But it was the description he gave of encountering this familiar thing in a completely unusual way, in a devastating way. But to me, the poetry of his description was exactly like somebody would describe sculpture, where you can't name the object that you're looking at, but your way of encountering it or walking around it creates an entirely new description of the experience that you're having. And I thought it was just incredibly moving. And it was a trigger to thinking of upturned objects and the way you might flip something over and it becomes a completely different thing. And so that was the source of these three upturned houses. And this is the third of those three, and it's a broken upturned house. The surprise of it is obviously something that I definitely caught. You know, I enjoy that way of working, especially with sculpture, which is so physically static. You know, to be involved in something which refuses to have a finite starting point or end point is to me quite important.
Phyllida Barlow is the third artist selected by the Norton for their Recognition of Art by Women exhibition, and she's the first sculptor to be included. Her work is on display throughout late February, and you can find out more by visiting the Norton Museum website at norton.org.
Always try not to categorize myself. That's a problem because the world is one in which they need to know who you are. And so oftentimes I take on the identity of purely being a rock and roll photographer.
Mark Mormon is a Florida-based filmmaker. His work includes the Grammy-nominated Tom Dowd and The Language of Music. And he's currently working on a film about Miami music legend Henry Stone. Tonight, we present one of Mormon's short films about a different kind of South Florida institution. For those in the know, the three-word title says it all. Robert is here.
I'm a country boy that absolutely loves life here. Robert is here. It's a name that was born out of necessity. My dad was farming and he was down, dead, broke, he had no money at all. So he put me out on the corner on a Saturday middle of November, 1959, with a little table made out of plywood and boxes, a field crate to sit on, maybe 4 or 5 bushels of cucumbers. I was just 6 years old. I sat there all day long, and absolutely nobody stopped. And Dad come to pick me up, and he couldn't understand. How could that many people not want cucumbers? So the next day, I had the same cucumbers and these two huge signs that simply proclaimed Robert is here. And I sold out and walked home. And so the next Sunday we were here, a couple of farmers brought over some stuff, beans, yellow squash, and zucchinis. So it started to snowball. And all these farmers, they would always see this little fat tow-headed kid sitting there, and they'd bring vegetables and just give them to me to sell. And I'd be out there every day. And that's how Robert is here got started. Just out of necessity. And the first few years was making money to help the family keep this head above water. It's just, we had to do it. And then I started making a little money on my own, and we did pretty good. Bought some property when I was 14, and was on my way. It just evolved. We're still evolving. We're learning how to do things old-fashioned and backwards, but in better old-fashioned backwards ways, because we're not modern at all. I still add up on the paper bag. I've never clicked a mouse on a computer. My kids all went to college, all 4 of them. They all come back to the farm. And even though they're college educated, they try to keep it as old fashioned backwards as we can. You know, that's our niche. You know, you can get modern anywhere you want to nowadays. The good old fashioned quality, values, as well as the way we do things, you can't find.
To learn more about the filmmaker, visit his website at markmorman.com. And of course, you can find Robert as well. Look for him at robertishere.com.
As far as my early development goes, I was from the Midwest and, you know, community theater, high school theater, and I knew this is what I wanted to do, but it wasn't until I came to Miami to this program, and they said that very first day to us, like, you are artists of tomorrow and you guys are it, and I suddenly felt like, I really am an actor and this is going to be my life.
Lynn Goldsmith is an award-winning photographer. Her work has graced the covers and pages of Life, Newsweek, Time, Rolling Stone, Sports Illustrated, and Elle Magazine, just to name a few. Her subjects have varied from entertainment personalities to sports stars, and the story of rock and roll lives in Goldsmith's photographs. In her new book, Rock and Roll Stories, she shares the best of this work, and her commentary takes us into the studio, onto the tour bus, in the concert hall, and on the streets where the pictures were made. We caught up with Ms. Goldsmith during her visit to Miami Book Fair International in November.
In Rock and Roll Stories, you know, I kind of laugh when I'm asked what the favorite pictures are, because the first things in my mind are really all the pictures of me. I was really young and I had no idea I was that pretty. So I really wanted to do a book where I could just show people what I look like in my, in my dear youth. I wrote a lot in the opening about that journey of being a girl who grew up in Detroit, who moved to Miami Beach during the invasion of the Beatles. You know, the people that I met, the life experiences that I had led me to the path. I did not intend on being a photographer. I loved making images because it connected me. I was more comfortable with a camera.
1, 2, 3, 4!
You know, the pictures of people who are very dear to me that are no longer here, like Frank Zappa. You know, like anybody else, when you look at photographs of people who have passed, or there's an image in the book of Bob Dylan with Levon Helm, and the time that the three of us spent together was, you know, made even stronger for me, that moment was captured on film and that I could tell the story in Rock and Roll Stories. I actually always try not to categorize myself. That's a problem because the world is one in which they need to know who you are. And so oftentimes I take on the identity of purely being a rock and roll photographer, which is what the whole book Rock and Roll Stories is about, in that I saw myself just as a photographer and could not accept that title, rock and roll. It was like, what does that mean? But now that I'm older, and that's an incredibly sexy term now, I'm happy to take it on. Part of the reason for breaking it up into chapters like On the Road is because there are so many people who wonder what that's like. And my job is really to be that person, to be the fan backstage, whether it's in the bathroom or when they're on the stage, you know, to give that point of view. Music is the connector. So I try to think about what music would that person like. And if it's a jazz person, like I photographed Miles Davis or other jazz people, I try to think of music that would be obscure, that would be inspiring to them. And so if I have that on when they walk in the room, it completely changes the vibration of when they meet me, because it's kind of like, oh, we're connected. For me, it's a major part of my process, no matter where I am, and even if I wasn't doing rock and roll. Actually, there's only one artist that I've ever photographed who said no music and was very locked into that, because to tell you the truth, I'm not that comfortable without some music playing, and that was here in Miami Beach, and it was Isaac Bashevis Singer. It was quite a unique experience for me to have that kind of very quiet connection. But Isaac Bashevis Singer is a rock star. Having that camera with me all the time is still part of my journey, because it makes me more aware of everything around me.
You can learn more about Lynn Goldsmith by visiting her website at lynngoldsmith.com, and there you can see some of her portraits and see more of her work.
I shot a whole bunch of pictures. You know, I just kept shooting. So I figured one of these has to be good. And one of them actually did turn out to be good, kind of an iconic photo. Well, the first days are
the hardest days. Young Arts Week, which began on January 6th, takes place in Miami each year and enables approximately 170 participants in the Young Arts program to work with distinguished master teachers and mentors. Young Arts Week is designed to support young artists at a critical juncture in their lives and encourages their decision to pursue a career in the arts. The list of Young Arts alums reads like a who's who in the arts, and at last year's gathering, we had a chance to talk with some of the recent alums who have come back to give to the program.
Young Arts Week for 31 years has always brought in about 150 students, give or take, from all around the country, who are some of the, you know, most talented young artists from all around the country in all the different fields. When you think about who these kids are, you know, this was Adrienne Grenier that we found at 17, and Viola Davis, who we found at 17, and Nicki Minaj, who we found at 17, and Chris Young, the country superstar, who we found at 17, and Desmond Richardson, and Vanessa Williams. And so the talent is extraordinary. You know, when people start hearing high school and how great can that be, but these are those next great artists that everybody is going to hear and see on Broadway and Carnegie Hall, Alvin Ailey. So they really are remarkably, remarkably talented young artists. We get these great alums to come back and give back to the organization that helped them get their start. Andrew Reynolds, who is another one of our Young Arts alum, who was the star, the lead of Book of Mormon.
I was a finalist in 1997. I came down to Miami from Omaha, Nebraska, where I'm from, and competed. Well, I mean, the first time was a huge deal for me. I didn't come from a large arts background. Didn't come from a high school that had a large arts program. So this was the first time coming down here was really, and I talked about it with Susanna Shatkovsky, who was also in my discipline that year in 97. It was the first time we were ever called artists.
It was actually the most defining experience, I would say, in my acting career as far as my early development goes. I was from the Midwest and, you know, community theater, high school theater, and I knew this is what I wanted to do, but it wasn't until I came to Miami to this program and they said that very first day to us, like, you are artists of tomorrow and you guys are it. And I suddenly felt like I really am an actor and this is going to be my life.
I mean, it really did, that confidence that I was sort of instilled with through this program kind of carried me through my first couple years in New York. It was the best thing for me.
It's an incredible opportunity to work with young artists that are so amazingly talented. It's not the norm, it's not the normal slice of a class or group of students and artists that you normally get to work with. So they find these extremely talented, creative human beings that we get to come in and just share some of our knowledge. But a program like this, even for me, I think would have made me value my talents and my abilities a lot more and not take them for granted.
The inspiration, it was so palpable to me and it fed me, my spirit so deeply that I actually carry it like to this day. Like I still have the young arts spark and it, you know, and it's not easy to be an actor. So I'm very grateful that I have that little flame and to keep me warm.
I think I was alone with a group of people who didn't really share the same passion that I did or the same dream of leaving their hometowns and moving to New York. And all of a sudden I was surrounded by, you know, 20 kids who all wanted to do the same thing. So it didn't feel weird to me, it felt less scary. And the fact that I moved to New York, really not knowing anybody, but the people that I did know were from Young Arts. It was Susanna and Celestina Villanueva and Michael Washington. They were all in my group and they all moved to New York at the same time. And those are my friends and they're still my friends.
The master classes are amazing things that you just never get to experience because these are the icons that you see on TV and you watch on the stage, but they're there at this very human level. Mikhail Baryshnikov loves working with the young artists because it inspires them. You know, they're so far advanced in their career, but they all come back and say the same thing, that when they're working with these young artists, it's not just helping the young artists, it's helping them. It's reinvigorating and inspiring them.
That not all these kids will go on to be artists, but they will certainly go on to be more well-rounded folks in whatever their profession is. And I think what this particular program does is they encourage and it fosters a confidence in these young people that maybe they're not getting otherwise.
The Borscht Film Festival was born and comes out of Young Arts. That was Lucas Leyva and others who were Young Arts winners, and that's how they went on to develop the Borscht Film Festival, and they're here. And Terrell Alvin McCraney, you know, one of the great, you know, playwrights, was speaking to another one of our alums just earlier today named Desmond Richardson, who's gone on to become one of the great modern ballet dancers of our time and founded Complexions, and that's in New York, and he's now actually talking about moving his company from New York to Miami. Young Arts was born and raised in Miami. Young Arts was founded in Miami. It's our home. It's who we are.
For more information on Young Arts and Young Arts Week, visit their website at youngarts.org. And in February, tune in for WPBT2's presentation of Jazz Roots, Jazz and the Philharmonic. This amazing performance is a collaboration between my great friends at the Adrian Arts Center, the University of Miami Frost School of Music, and Young Arts. It features a superstar roster of award-winning jazz and classical artists, including Bobby McFerrin, Dave Grusin, and Shelley Berg, with the University of Miami's Henry Mancini Institute Orchestra and Young Arts All-Star alumni. And that wraps it up for this week. Remember, for more arts and culture, visit wpbt2.org/artloft, where you will find featured videos, blogs, and information on upcoming arts events. And as if you've missed any, you can also see older episodes of Art Loft. And be sure to look for us on Facebook and Twitter at ArtLoftSFL. Until next time, I'm Kalyn James, reminding you to stay creative. See ya.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation, the Miami-Dade County Tourist Development Council, the Miami-Dade County Department of Cultural Affairs and the Cultural Affairs Council, the Miami-Dade County Mayor, and the Board of County Commissioners. And
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.